Net zero energy buildings are now trending all over the world. The net zero energy building market is expected to grow at a compound annual rate of around 30 to 40% from 2023 to 2030. We see the trajectory, but what's the secret to actually hitting a net zero energy target? Is it the latest renewable technology, the most efficient heating or cooling systems? Sure, equipment performance helps building performance. But before anyone goes looking for the right chiller, consider this. The first step really is to give the net zero energy target the right form. This form will determine the success of a project's ambitions or its failure. So, what does form mean? And how do we enter this process of form making? Hi there, my name is Nirmal Krishnani. I'm a sustainable design strategist, author and educator based in Singapore. In this video, I will share with you the three key factors that I know can make or break any net zero energy building, whatever the context or climate conditions. I will also show you how several real life projects met their goals. And stick around, because at the end, I will let you in on what is perhaps the most surprising and undervalued ingredient of any net zero energy strategy. Let's get to it. This video is sponsored by the Holcim Foundation for Sustainable Construction. More on them later. The textbook definition of a net zero energy building is one that produces as much energy as it consumes over the course of a year. Put it another way, production must equal consumption, and this energy must be renewably sourced using whatever is available on site. The site and the natural resources that it offers represents your budget, if you will. Let's start by estimating this budget, which is very much like a cost budget. Figure out what you can afford. Every parcel of land can produce just so much power using any given technology within its particular climate and latitude. Also, every building has a limited room for mounting renewables. Now, these two constraints put together dictate how much you can produce, what your budget is. Let's use solar PV as a technology of reference. On a project site close to the equator, PV panels installed horizontally are the most effective because they face the overhead sun. And since the roof is often the most productive surface of the building, the larger the roof, the greater the energy potential. In higher and lower latitudes, however, a building's facades could also be considered good alternatives for placing PV panels on, since the sun moves to low angles in the southern or northern hemispheres over the course of a year. Therefore, here, building height can be viewed as an asset. The key is to figure out just how panels are distributed on the site and how many you can realistically fit onto the building. A building can be tall or short, wide or narrow, oriented this way or that way. Each option, depending on the building's exact location, will produce a different amount of energy. So the goal is to maximize production without bursting the cost budget. At this stage in the process, there are several solar modeling tools available to you to visualize and optimize the link between building form and energy. You just need to pick one to guide you through this analysis. Later on, I'll show you a project whose form is a direct consequence of sun angles. Its geometry is unlike most buildings, even in its part of the world. So, as we've seen, form constrains energy production. Interestingly, it also impacts energy demand. Even if the link between the two is not straightforward, the question of demand is tied to solar exposure. How much of the sun's energy does a building receive? Is this energy deflected or does it infiltrate the building? How does it ultimately affect occupant comfort? Now, in warm climates, the primary goal is to shield and dissipate solar energy. Passive strategies such as cross-ventilation do well to improve comfort. These are particularly effective if a building is narrow, north-south facing, and permeable. But in cold climates, the inverse is true. Buildings must be compact with insulated and airtight envelopes. They must hold in the warmth. Implicitly, success on the energy front is contingent on success in achieving comfort for the occupants. Which begs a fundamental question. What is comfort exactly? There is a popular misconception about comfort that I must call out right off the bat. We do not need to have the same temperature all the time everywhere. We simply don't. The human body is adaptable to a wide range of varying ambient conditions like temperature, air movement, humidity, etc. To say that we all need 24 degrees centigrade all the time is a gross oversimplification. A net zero energy building is, by design, comfort smart. It is engineered to permit limited fluctuations of indoor temperature and light in sync with the climate and weather conditions. And it does so by relying partly on the human body's ability to adapt to these variations. It also gives occupants control over their environment via, say, a thermostat or a ceiling fan, blinds or operable windows. Before the energy model of a building can be detailed, we must organize the floor plans into passive and active zones, decide which rooms are going to be mechanically cooled or heated, which ones should be naturally ventilated, or maybe which ones could be a hybrid of the two, combining passive and active modes in new ways. This multimodal approach is less energy intensive and more satisfying than a uniform interior. Once a building's form and thermal zones have been mapped out, efforts must go into figuring out the electromechanical systems that will close the gap. Now, the efficiency of these systems is of course critical. A qualified project engineer can make a call on which system would perform best for a given budget. Equally important though is the integration of these systems, how they talk to each other. For instance, areas with daylight can be fitted with sensors that switch lights on and off. Parts of a facade might be operable so that occupants can open a window when outdoor conditions permit. Sensors and building automation systems, or smart technologies as they're commonly known, can easily manage system-to-system exchanges or begin to anticipate human behavior. The goal here is to limit the use of energy-intensive systems, like air conditioning, to spend energy only where it is needed and to the extent that it is required. Remember, we only have a limited energy budget at our disposal. How all of this is done may best be understood by looking at a few existing net zero energy buildings in different climates and settings. But before we look at these, let me quickly tell you about the world's most significant competition for sustainable design, with a total prize pool of $1 million, the Holcim Foundation Awards. Francis Carey, the acclaimed architect, won the Global Gold Award in 2012. Prior to winning, few had heard of him, and since, his profile has skyrocketed. At Ecogradia, we celebrate award winners like Carey. This year, we're spotlighting the 2023 winners in an exclusive webinar series. And who knows, next year, you might well be a part of this inspiring group of changemakers. The portal for online submissions for the next cycle of the Holcim Foundation Awards is now open, and it will stay open until February 2025. And it's free. Find out more in our show notes or at awards.holcimfoundation.org. The Avasara Academy in India is a good example of how net zero energy buildings do not need to rely on expensive technologies. In fact, the most effective solutions are often low cost and locally sourced. And this is a crucial takeaway, especially for projects situated in places where budgets are tight. The academy, completed in 2019, is made up of 7 four-story blocks with classrooms and dormitories. It is some 14,000 square meters in area, located about 10 kilometers from the city of Pune, within a tropical climate that has a semi-arid influence. And the design challenge here comes from overheating. Summer temperatures can reach 42 degrees centigrade. What's remarkable about Avasara is its reliance on basic principles of thermodynamics. Each block breathes through a series of earth tubes that run underneath its structure. Outside air is drawn into these tubes and naturally cooled through heat exchange with the ground before rising to enter the classrooms. The tubes are also connected to these vertical shafts that open to solar chimneys on the roof. These shafts draw in air from adjacent rooms, creating an enhanced airflow that cuts across the depth of the floor plate. This simple yet very clever system, combined with thermal mass and ceiling fans, creates comfortable spaces year-round. The facades of the building showcase another straightforward solution: bamboo shading screens that can be adjusted to control sunlight and ventilation. Now, these screens can help reduce solar heat gain. The result, a whopping 80% reduction in annual energy costs. For the remaining 20%, there are solar panels on the roof which provide enough power for ceiling fans and lights. Meanwhile, solar water heaters supply hot water for showers. Avasara Academy is a great example of the power that passive design can have in warm climates. Let's head north now, way north, to see how to strategize performance in one of the world's coldest regions. In Porsgrunn, Norway, the powerhouse Telemark goes beyond net zero energy. It produces more than it needs, making it a net positive building. Completed in 2020, the building is situated in a subarctic climate where winter conditions can often drop to minus 10 degrees centigrade. Needless to say, the design challenge here is mostly heat loss. Within its 8,400 square meters of total floor area, the Telemark houses mainly offices and co-working spaces. The building's most striking feature is its distinctive silhouette: an 11-story skewed monolith with a dramatic 24-degree slope roof and a bold 45-degree notch carved into its facade. Now, these aren't arbitrary choices. each angle was precisely calculated to serve the building's ambitious energy goals. The tilted roof extends beyond the building's footprint, maximizing surface area available for solar collection. Now, this expanded plane plus the PV-clad south-oriented facade generate altogether 256 megawatt hours annually, enough to power 20 Norwegian households. In fact, the building also boasts a yearly reduction of energy consumption of about 70% compared to similar new offices in the country. Now, this feat was made possible by fitting the facades with triple glazed windows and providing super insulation that created a very robust thermal barrier. There is also a highly efficient lighting system that works with daylight from the facades. Even the building's structure is called into action. The concrete slabs aren't just load-bearing elements. They absorb thermal energy during the day and release it slowly in the evening. This passive temperature regulation is aided by a minimalist material palette of local wood and gypsum and carpet tiles. What makes Powerhouse Telemark remarkable is how it challenges the conventions of form. The designers at Snowite are considered energy targets right at the drawing board to determine the shape of the structure. The result is a building in which form and function achieve a rare harmony, where every angle, every surface serves to increase the building's total energy budget. From Porsgrunn, we go to Amsterdam, to what has been labeled the smartest building on Earth. The Edge, as this building is known, isn't just smart, it's super intelligent. It's a showcase for how real-time data can be channeled into the day-to-day operations of a building through deep integration, what is commonly referred to as the Internet of Things. This 40,000 square meter office complex, which opened in 2015, is located in a temperate maritime climate where temperatures can drop to 2 degrees centigrade in winter and rise to 20 degrees centigrade in summer. At the core of the Edge's integrative approach is a network of around 28,000 sensors that create what's called a digital ceiling. Now, these sensors monitor everything in the building: motion, light, temperature, humidity, infrared signatures. Think of them like synapses in our brains, collecting and analyzing data to optimize user comfort and energy efficiency. This system begins working even before occupants walk in. Through a smartphone app developed by the company Deloitte, the building's main tenant, employees are connected to the building systems. As soon as they arrive on site, the building recognizes their cars and guides them each to an available parking lot. The app then reviews their schedules and helps them plan their day. Instead of assigned desks, the Edge uses real-time occupancy data to match each employee with the perfect workspace for their needs. A sitting desk, a standing desk, the work booth, a meeting room, balcony seat, or concentration room. As people move through the building, it automatically adjusts lighting and temperature to their stored preferences, creating these personalized comfort zones that follow them throughout the day. One might think that this degree of personalization increases energy use, but the opposite is in fact true. By tracking the occupant, the system reduces energy waste. On days when few employees are expected, entire sections of the building can be shut down, dramatically reducing the energy needed for heating and cooling and lighting and cleaning. Overall, the Edge uses 70% less electricity than a typical office building in the same context. Now, the many concepts and systems tapped on in each of these projects are not new. They've been around for a while. What is new is how they are put together, how they're combined to support each other and make the sum greater than the parts. This is the ingredient that I alluded to at the very beginning of the video that is so often overlooked in the early stages of a project. This alchemy depends on how we, consultants, experts, owners, occupants, come together at the drawing board. This aspect of the work is not easy to achieve. Forging and enforcing a shared vision is perhaps the most challenging part of the undertaking. So much depends on the temperament and buy-in of various consultants and stakeholders. In a previous project I worked on in Singapore, we used the integrated design process, as the approach is called, to move things along. The IDP prescribes, for instance, design charrettes, whole team meetings lasting a couple of days where ideas are tossed and flipped, goals and targets are set and reset. This is hard work, but well worth the trouble. A net zero energy building is a technical achievement, yes. It is necessary for a low carbon future, absolutely. But it can also forge a new culture of thinking and acting. My team walked away from our project feeling empowered, eager to do it all again with another project. And this is as worthy a goal as any engineering feat. Do you know of a net zero energy building in your city or region perhaps that people should know about? What do you think of it? Let me know in the comments. And if you'd like to learn more about the Powerhouse Telemark in Norway that we looked at earlier, you can watch next my conversation with Kjetil Thorsen of Snøhetta, the company responsible for its design. And as always, thank you so much for watching.